Thank you very much. Thank you again for having the opportunity to be here and present to fellow theosophists. Because to me, this path started in theosophy. When in 1977, I make a little cabin in the province of Avila in Spain, I was looking for something. And I built this cabin in the woods with branches, stones. Was the August, September. And I decided to be there in silence on my own. I asked a shepherd to let me a little container with milk. I didn't want to talk, I paid him in advance. He was to put it in a rock in a particular place. And it was a time of the year than the main tree was a fig tree with figs ready to be eaten, and apples, peaches, and all kind of stuff. Nature was available to me. And I took with me for 45 days of silence this little book at the feet of the master. This is the Spanish version, a copy of the one that I took with me, and was my companion for those 45 days. And based on that, I did some of my practices. I didn't have idea about anything else. I went to Madrid. I asked in a bookstore, who is this Krishnamurti? And they told me, go to the Theosophical Society. They just opened. They had been closed for 40 years. Go over there. And I went over there and found my family and changed my life. And one thing they told me, Fernando, if you want to go deeper in this, you need to learn English. And I was 33 at that time, and I says, well, I was 31 when that happened, and I says, where to go? And they told me, go to the United States. And I decided to take some yoga courses in Canada with the ashram of Sivananda. And from there, I start to get invitations to the next place and the next place and the next place. In one place, I was getting invitation to the next. And I went to the Himalayan Institute. I met Joy Mills at the bookstore in New York. She gave me a scholarship. I didn't speak any English yet, okay? I was in the process. And then I went to Crotona, met my wife, we went to India, and we came to Worcester, Massachusetts, start life from scratch, from zero. But very active, giving lectures on theosophy, going to Latin America, to New York, here and there, studying, teaching the divine plan, the sacred doctrine, this, that. I became member of the board with Tim and with Barry. We were having our big discussions there and all those kind of things. But I was doing jobs that they were not fulfilling. We are just jobs to pay the rent, to this and that. And I was not wanting to continue doing those things. This is why I came to the United States. Of course, I came because my wife, because I love her dearly. And I promised her that we were coming to Worcester. She has two daughters of her first marriage, and the kids were needing us to go to college and all those kind of things. And one day, in my desperation, being trapped in Worcester for so long, I told Master of the Wisdom, we are doing all this kind of, can I do something more useful? And I quit my job as a printer. And I became a medical interpreter. And I started to learn the conversations in between doctors and Latino patients. For 1 year and a half, I spent 40 hours a week interpreting, knowing the feelings on one side and the other side. Tobacco treatment specialist, therapist, with one of the addictions that is more difficult to get. And my teacher was the best in the whole country, Dr. Judy O'Keefe from the University of Massachusetts Medical School. Then I was to find she was the boss of John Kabat-Zinn. He was working in her department. But that year I went to Boston to a conference the mind and the body and soul conference, and I met John. And after I explained to him all the things that I was doing, he invited me to have lunch with him in UMass. And he asked me if I was wanting to take his training and his program. And I told him, says, John, I have been doing all this teaching for free through the years, through the Theosophical Society, about yoga, about all these things. And he says, well, if you join my team, you will be able to continue doing the same work and make a living. And I says, okay. And then when I started to take the training, I says, wait a minute, what is all this? I have been teaching and studying yoga. What is the second of the aphorism of the Yoga Sutras of Patanjali? Yoga Chitta Vritti Nirodha. Yoga is the quietening of the alterations of the mind. What is this program doing? It's doing that. Helping people to move out of struggle by quietening the mind. And this program has four stages. I call it the four stages of mindfulness. I developed the program for a prisons in New Jersey through Rutgers University. And what happened? What are those four stages? The Viveka Shudamani of Sankaracharya. Discernment, desirelessness, exact. Says, wait a minute. And how was developed? Based on the Sati Patthana Sutta, the Sutra of Attention of the Buddha, following exactly the same process. But all of this in a lay language, talking in the language of the people. Talking on the language of the people. And immediately grasped me. Here is a theosophist that I was looking for a way to live the life that we were teaching in our lodges, and happened. And I started to make a living in that way and pay my mortgage and bring food to the home and spend vacations with the grandkids and teaching what I was wanting to teach. That is what the whole thing is about. Recently, I was invited to go to Brazil as the keynote speaker at the University of Sao Paulo. And they told me that they were wanting to do my presentation in English because they were only having interpreters from English into Portuguese. And I don't speak Portuguese. In this case, I did it. And when I was building this, I thought about coming here. And I am using the same presentation. And I asked John Kabat-Zinn to do greetings for the conference down there. And he agreed, and I did the recording of him in June with my phone. And it's a little noisy. I will explain what he says. The only thing is, mindfulness has become a fashion. And it's not a fashion. It's something tremendously serious. It's a way of living the life in the present moment. That is the whole idea. And he was mentioning there, I hope I can go next year or in 2 years to Brazil, Latin America. He's coming with me to Spain. We are going to do a tour in next March. He says, but remember that mindfulness is your own life. It's your own practice. It's not a new teaching or a new technique. It's not that. And I will try to explain this today here. I met him in Boston at the Body and Soul Conference, as I mentioned. Discovering mindfulness. The mind in its natural state is as clear and pristine as the waters of a high mountain lake. But in the moment came to take part of what is this human form, got immediately tainted by the whole process of evolution. And our role is to return it to that particular way. The wind knows that. And yesterday, I recited this particular poem. I will not do it again, but the wind one brilliant day called to my soul, etc. Some of you were not here or yesterday, or raise your hand if you were not. Okay, I will recite it. The wind one brilliant day called to my soul with an odor of jasmine. In return for this jasmine odor, I will like all the odor of your roses. I have no roses. I have no flowers in my garden anymore. All are dead. I will take the cry of the fountains, the yellow leaves, the dried-up petals. The wind left, I wept. Soul, what you had done with the garden entrusted to you. Soul, what you had done with the garden entrusted to you. Again, we all have a garden that we came to cultivate, and that is our role. But most of the people start to try to please their father, their mother, their uncle, their grandmother, their teacher, their professor, their whatever, and they forget about their own role in this life. And the idea is, finally, one day you knew what you have to do and begin. No matter if you are in your 80s. Are you trying to please someone? What are you trying to do, what you really need to do? Breath, prana, consciousness. Breath equal life. Breathing is an essential element of life. It would be appropriate to say that life is in the physical realm, it starts with a breath and will finish with a breath, as was mentioned. The air that we breathe and sustains our living doesn't discriminate about who has the right to it and who doesn't. It is available for free to be utilized by the living organism of nature as needed, including every human being on this planet. Our physical body, which has its own intelligence, manifested as instinct, knows about it and uses it automatically since the very beginning. Breathing becomes one of the first automatic processes in us in such a way that for the most of the time, we don't need to be concerned about breathing. Only when some accident occurs in a moment, deep struggle, we will breathe and request the breath, because it's not there, to regain our stability. Breathing just happens, no matter if we are awake or asleep. Providing an essential element to our physicality, nourishing every cell, every organ, the whole organism, is always present. In good moments and in bad moments. It's in conscious or unconscious moments. It is life moving through us. The senses need the breath to function, and also the thinking mind. There are nothing without the breath. Imagine if one of the requirements to be alive was to breathe intentionally all the time. We all will be dead. If you need to breathe intentionally, forget it. The human beings in our present state of evolution are living in constant struggle, in constant battle with everyone, including ourselves, and with everything. Conscious and unconscious feelings of fear, sorrow, insecurity, pain are constantly flying through our mind in 100,000 directions, creating stress and suffering. We are a bunch of contradictions. The mind is constantly contradicting itself. That one idea about one-pointedness in most of us is just an ideal. Because the mind is the one who is ruling the whole thing. Where this blindness and this confusion came from? How we can overcome all this? Are we able to? Do we have the capacity to regain stability and harmony? How can we get the necessary clarity, sense of purpose, and strength to have a joyful life? to begin, we will need to understand what differences exist between us and the other kingdoms of nature. And in Theosophy, we study all those kind of things. We have a physical structure composed of the same chemical elements that are present in minerals, plants, and animals. We are emotional. We have sensibilities, feelings, attractions, repulsions that is present almost in all the kingdoms of nature. We have mental faculties. The more basic ones are also present in some of the mammals. We have inherited all of that, but it was not until the arrival of self-awareness, mentality, and thought that the deep emotional turmoil and struggle started. The reasoning mind, the self-identity, gave us certain freedoms, or perhaps gave us the impression that we were free, but in reality, the majority of human beings became like corks in the middle of the ocean. At the mercy of the deeply rooted tendencies inherited with the physical body, including conflicting feelings, strong desires, constructed and destructive emotions, all of them manipulated by thoughts, by entrained perceptions, then provided to us by the senses, and by memories deeply rooted in our limbic system from this life experience or from ancestral memories engraved in each one of ourselves at physical, emotional, and mental level. We are representing the whole humanity from the very beginning in each one of us. And we have the obligation of that redemption individually. It's our inheritance. It's not the one of my father or my mother or my previous karma. No, we are carrying the whole karma of humanity in our shoulders. Don't be so selfish, my karma. No. It's the whole thing. And we have the whole tools to be able to explore that. Where all that suffering and that blindness is coming from, and how to allow the light to shine through again. From there is where all the chaos came. And when I found MBSR, and when I saw taking my initial training, I was in class number 4 taking the training, and my teacher, Ferris Urbanowski, came and says, Fernando, John Kabat-Zinn wanna talk to you. I says, okay, I will go to talk to him. And I went to his office and he says, I want you to start to teach in May. And I says, but I only have seen 4 classes, and it's 8 classes. He says, do you want to teach or not? Like that. And I said, yes, yeah, I will do it. I will do it. I said, well, what a trouble. And I was doing double practice than the patients we are doing in that. But I told him after I saw the whole thing, I said, John, chapeau. I put my hand, I bow in front of you, because you have been able to bring the ancient wisdom into a hospital clinic to the people that are suffering the most. And in the language of the people, in a way that can reach their heart. And they can use all that wisdom and compassion that is the inherited of every human being, not of just few here and there. All of them have it. Anyway, this was, now we go to the show here. Consciousness is available to everything that breathes. Prana is consciousness. In one of the Body and Soul conferences, John Kabat-Zinn was giving a talk, and he started with that expression. Prana is consciousness. Prana, or life energy, is what makes possible for us. Well, consciousness is available to everything that breathes. Prana is consciousness. Prana, or life energy, is what makes it possible for us to see, to smell, to feel, to listen, to taste, and to remember. If you don't have it, forget about it. Luminous consciousness is eternal, and these are phrases for reflection. Luminous consciousness is eternal. It is all. Therefore, it doesn't exist. Because if it exists, it's not eternal. for that reason, doesn't exist in the way we think is existence. Prana is inseparable from consciousness. And this energy has no distinction between good and evil. It's just pure energy. It's the intention behind the one who make it good or evil. Is the selfish or the unselfish that will conduct that energy to operate in one way or other. And I remember there in the second part of the Bhagavad Gita, when Krishna says, Arjuna tell to Krishna, please, can you tell me who you are? Do you really want to know? Please. And he opens his chest. And he shows that he is the creator, he is the destroyer, and he is the supporter. And the reality is that is every human being. You are that, Tatwanasi. We create our own life. We destroy our own life. We sustain our own life. We have the responsibility for the life that has been given to us. No one else. Don't blame any one like we were the other day exploring. And consciousness functions through embodiment. Through embodiment. Consciousness and memory. Physical consciousness, bodily desires. It wants to repeat the pleasant and avoid the unpleasant. Emotional consciousness, sense of anticipation. It is awakened by sensory perceptions. Mental consciousness, thinking mind, combination with thoughts, feelings, and or emotions, which leads to constant struggle and agitation. And then ego consciousness, self comes to mind. That is the title of the book of a neuroscientist, Antonio Damasio. That is, you are interested on how physiological work the brain and the whole nervous system, he is the biggest authority. But when he reached the point of spirituality, he stops there. He stops there. We need to help him to make the jump, okay? We need to help him to make the jump. Now I'm going to use, it's a little long, but it's the limbic system. Where is the whole problem in the brain, human brain, is in the amygdala. That little gland that I call it in my classes, the attic or the basement. Of the body. What do you normally in your house put in the attic or the basement? All the junk, no? But that is what we put over there in our experience in life. The amygdala is the key subcortical brain center that coordinates behavioral, neural, immunological, and hormonal responses to environmental threats. It also serves as the storage house of emotional memory within the brain. Its function is to compare incoming signals from the environment with stored emotional, memories. In this way, the amygdala makes instantaneous decisions about the threat level of incoming sensory information. Due to the extensive connections to the hypothalamus and the another autonomic nervous system centers, the amygdala is able to activate the autonomic nervous system and emotional responses before the higher brain centers receive the sensory information. In other hand, if you see a little ball running in the middle of the street and you see a car coming at big speed, who is behind a ball running into the street? Kid. Huh? Are you going to stop to see the driver is chatting on the phone or the color of the car and you see the child running? What are you going to do? You grab the kid. And where all that energy comes from? The amygdala, through the senses, perceive the danger and immediately react and bring all the adrenaline and everything necessary to that particular situation. Now, when real or imaginary, you start to feel threats daily because you have a drunken partner or that accumulates and accumulates and accumulates and accumulates and start to create problems. And although dragging all the, my father was mean to me and the other did that to me like he was explaining, is the same. Everything that is in the amygdala. But the problem with us humans, the day we decide to clean the attic, what happened? When you decide to clean the attic or the basement, you find a box, a shoe box at the entrance. What is in a shoe box?
Memories.
Pictures. Look, and merely how pretty she is. Forget about the cleaning. We will do it for another weekend, okay? We get distracted very, very easily. Here is where it happened in stress, okay? You get the perception, cortisol immediately send the alarm, the adrenals start to send adrenaline, and if it's a regular living, it has a positive function. The acute reaction enhances immunity, memory, energy replacement, cardiovascular function. But in chronic situations, when you have a repetitive situation that is draining you, then you have a suppressed immune system, the memory goes away, the loss of bone minerals, muscle wasting, metabolic syndrome, all kinds of chronic conditions start to show up. Okay? And here you have all the thing that is involved. The human brain under stress, prefrontal cortex, this is the area of decision making, working memory, self-regulatory behaviors, mood and impulses, hippocampus, memory of daily events, spatial memory, mood regulation, helps to shut off a stress response, like the other one, but then the amygdala, anxiety, fear, aggression, turns on stress hormones and increase heart rate. That is the function in there. And I will not go more with this, just to give you a general picture. This is very recent. Now with the latest equipments, they are able to investigate the brain. But in the area of plasticity, what has been discovered this last year is that by doing these practices of meditation with full attention and intention, you open a dialogue in between the prefrontal cortex intelligence with directly, knowing the one circuit or the first circuit or the other, then you do a little reasoning. No, goes directly to the amygdala, and the prefrontal, they tell the amygdala, can you cool down, please? Becomes like the fire truck. Don't take it so much too hard. Are you seeing that it's damaging you? And make that particular. They had seen that there is now a conversation that until now they didn't realize was there. There is a direct conversation, physiological, of course. Two definitions: health, the condition of being sound in body, mind, and spirit. Healthy, wellness, and that is from the Webster Dictionary. Mindfulness, moment-to-moment non-judgmental awareness, cultivating by paying attention, etc. Do you know what kind of language is located? The language that we use in many of the expressions in the stress reduction class? Choiceless awareness of Krishnamurti. By reading this, it says, I'm familiar with that expression. I am familiar with that. From the 1960s, from the 1950s, from the 1970s, all here. Mindfulness and health. Mindful in the left, and mindful in the right. See it? Yeah? The appropriate tune for the situation. The mind creates complexity. Mindfulness brings back simplicity. Lack of attention, disattention, disconnection, dysregulation, disorder, disease. Attention, connection, regulation, order, and ease. Are you in the military or something like that? This is from 1890. William James, founder of psychology. physician in Harvard in those years. The faculty of voluntarily bringing back a wandering attention over and over again is the very root of judgment, character, and will. No one is composed sweet if he have it not. An education which should improve this faculty would be the education par excellence, the education of attention. But it is easier to define this ideal than to give practical instruction for bringing it about. Will take 90 years to take the ideas of the Sutra of Attention of the Buddha to put it into practice for the general public. This is August 21st, 1909, Worcester, Massachusetts, Clark University. Sigmund Freud, Stanley Hall, chairman of Clark, and John, yeah, Carl Jung. That is the trip that they did together to the United States to come to Worcester. I thought Worcester was not important. But not only that, here is the bunch of guys. Of course, those times, you know, it was the bunch of guys. Let's see if I can put the pointer here. Yeah. Okay, you have there Freud and Jung. And you know who is this? William James. William James. Then he came to Worcester to talk to Carl Jung and to Freud. And he worked with us. In our friend his book, we have that description of what happened in that walk and all those, you know. Albert, in the Albert's book, you find all the description of that. But in the annual, in the centenary, the annual of psychiatry got those pictures, and I took the pictures with my phone from it, okay? MBSR is about the cultivation of awareness. When alertness reaches a point of such intensity that effortlessly and spontaneously it discards all memories and aversions, all fears and hope, and is solely and supremely concerned with entire content on the present moment, outer and inner, subjective and objective, without separating the two, without a sense of duality between the me and the no-me, such a point of supreme alertness is called awareness. And this is a definition by Krishnamurti. This is a definition by Krishnamurti. Uh-huh. Now, where all this happened? UMass Medical Center in Worcester, Massachusetts. 1979, founded by Jon Kabat-Zinn, the first decade of the MBSR, Mindfulness-Based Stress Reduction Clinic, went very much unnoticed. These initial years were mainly exploratory, dedicated to the refinement of its initial curriculum through clinical application and a very modest level of research. In 1982, Jon Kabat-Zinn trained the first intern, Saki Santorelli, that is the present director of the Center for Mindfulness. Full Catastrophe Living and Healing Emotions. In 1989, Jon Kabat-Zinn decided to take a sabbatical to write a book that would present MBSR outside the walls of the hospital. Full Catastrophe Living was published simultaneously in USA and Canada in 1991. In the same year, he was invited to join a group of Western scholars to present their activities to His Holiness the Dalai Lama in Dharamsala. This was the third encounter of the Mind and Life Institute. The different presentations were compiled by Daniel Goldman in the book Healing Emotions. And we have here that particular group. You have here, of course, the Dalai Lama. Adam Engel is the businessman that really organized and created the whole movement of the Mind and Life. You have Cisco Varela, the neurologist, and with Adam went to the Dalai Lama to ask him if he was agreed to do research with his monks and meditators and use all this technology. You have there Alan Wallace, there in the corner, that is another of the teachers and has been also interpreter of the Dalai Lama through years. We have here Danielle Goldman. We have Sharon Salzberg, like the, I had eating with her several times. I know all these guys. Here is John Kabat-Zinn, looking younger, and here is the guy who has been also interpreter of the Dalai Lama for many years, and many others. But that was that encounter in Dharamsala in that particular year. In 1993, this year was officially for me, they started mind-body medicine, because it was a lot of money given by the Fetzer Foundation in Kalamazoo, Michigan, to write many books. And from there came the interest of the American journalist Bill Moyers of PBS to create the series Healing and the Mind. This was a success. Millions of people watched this particular program. And Jon Kabat-Zinn published his second book, Wherever You Go, There You Are, that sold 750,000 copies apparently in 1 year, in the moment came out. MBS are in prisons and inner city. The MBSR boom in 1993-94 generated grants to explore whether MBSR could also be useful in people serving in time in prison and in the inner city population. For over 7 years, these programs became a real success, helping to alleviate suffering among those who most need it. The programs were delivered in English and in Spanish. I became director and MBSR teacher of this inner city clinic myself in 1995. And here is four pictures, this welcome sign in the open house. A old hospital in Worcester, they gave me a whole floor for my clinic. I was able to do whatever I was wanting to do there. I have my two companions on organizing, and here in the picture, down here, and then one of my groups. We did 32 groups, I think. Some of them with 20, 25 people, and always with tie, okay, in my classes. Center for Mindfulness. This student popularity of the MBSR program that until then was a stress reduction program. It was necessary to create a center within the university and became the Center for Mindfulness in medicine, healthcare, and society. And this officially took place in a reunion by the stress reduction clinic administrators and teachers in the town of Hopedale, Massachusetts. But one of the planning meetings was in my house. And this picture was taken by my wife. And there we are in the porch behind my house, taking a break for the meeting. With John, John there, Ferris Urbanowski, my teacher, Larry Horwitz, the businessman. You always need to have the businessman involved. Okay, Saki Santorelli, etc. Then mindfulness-based cognitive therapy. From MBSR came MBCT, that has become very popular and has been accepted now in the Royal Kingdom of Great Britain as part of the treatment, and the medical system pays for it. And it's as good as pills, as they had said there. Okay? John Tisdale, Sindel Siegel, and Mark Williams, founder of MBCT, visited Worcester for the first time in 1993 following a suggestion given by John Tisdale and Marshall Linehan. They were looking to incorporate mindfulness techniques into traditional cognitive therapy interventions. They came back to Worcester in 95 with the intention to understand what was happening in the MBSR class and after this MBCT was born. And here we have Mark Williams, Marshall Linehan, and John Kabat-Zinn, and a statement by Mark Williams that is in one of his books. They did not try and fix or give solutions to problems raised. When patients say they felt sad, afraid, or that they have judgmental or hopeless thoughts, they were simply encouraged to bring these difficulties to awareness and breathe with them. And breathe with them, nothing else. Don't push them out. Don't try to put it under the rug. No, just move into it. Just move into it. And then finally in 1998, with all this boom, the professional group, internship group took form. And here we are here, the 8 core teachers in that particular year to do international training. My main role was in Spanish, of course, because it's my first language. And I just do a quick visit. MBSR in Latin America and Spain. I went with John Kabat-Zinn in 2000 to Argentina. 2001, I went back. And coming back September 10th, I left Buenos Aires of 2001. And I arrived to New York in September 11th, 2001. And I flew over those towers 15 minutes before they were put down, flying from New York to Boston, and I was reading a book of the Dalai Lama on universal compassion when that happened. And when I landed in Massachusetts, my wife was waiting for me, says, I don't know what happened, the suitcases didn't come, was a revolution around, we listened to the radio, a plane has have an accident with the tower, and as we were going home, the whole police of the whole state of Massachusetts driving towards Boston. We were going from Boston to Worcester, and everybody, one police, the whole troopers of the, because two of the planes came from there, took off from Boston. Anyway, that started the movement. Here is John with Dr. Gigante and myself in Buenos Aires. Machi is a young doctor there in Buenos Aires and is very dedicated to this. Then Jack Confield invited a group of Dharma teachers in Spanish to get together in his center in California to have a kind of connection among Dharma, Spanish-speaking Dharma teachers. We did that, and the third reunion was in Mexico. And it's when I started my tour in Mexico with Dr. Alejandro Cordova, that is here my friend, he passed away a couple of years ago, and then we went from there to Jalapa with a lady, I mean, one of the psychologists there. And then I was invited by Alejandro, says, Alejandro, we need to move this, and we need to have that book in Spanish, and we need to call it Atención Plena, and da-da-da. You know, we started to cook things together. And then in 2003, I did the first 5-day intensive in the Hotel Los Cocuyos, Huatusco, in Veracruz, Mexico. This guy here is now the president of the let's see where is the light. Of the, this one is the president of the Institute of Psychoanalysis in the Mexico Distrito Federal, and is that building was built by Eric Fromm, that was the teacher of Alejandro, my friend Alejandro. Yeah, and this is the whole group of physicians, psychoanalysts, all like that came to this particular first training. Then. Santiago, Chile, 2010, Spain, 2011. The picture at the beginning, the sunrise, is here in the Mediterranean Sea. And when we went to do walking meditation in the morning, everybody was stopping to see the sun coming through the ocean. This is another group of doctors and teachers. This is in Mexico again, in the Institute of Psychoanalysis with people from Venezuela, Ecuador, different countries. Then in the 2013 Monasterio de Poblet in Spain, the 5-day intensive. I will be doing again other now in October over there. And this one recently, 1 month ago in Chile, in a clinic over there. This has increased, is now in the whole planet. Is in the whole planet. And the thing is to maintain, we need to maintain the original roots. Has become a fashion, and everybody's like, know everything about it. But you need to practice yourself, you need to study yourself, you need to know yourself before you dare to do something like this. I did a tour in Burgos now in April. This is the hospital, University Hospital in Burgos, a province in Spain. The administration asked me to do 6 hours for the staff of the hospital. These are all doctors, nurses, psychologists, psychiatrists, all in the floor. Here we are having one of the conference rooms doing the practice. And they were asking me, can you come back in 3 months again, please? And it's a doctor there, the one who organized, because he has been teaching already to nurses the program, and his specialty is in HIV/AIDS. Then in psychiatry. This is the chairman of the department, Dr. Sedonas, and this is a first student from England and came to take the program with me. Then is another two students from Puerto Rico and from Spain. Then I went to the adolescence units. We have the whole hospital in Massachusetts, 18 theories was constructed. This is the first psychiatric hospital that was built in the United States. It was the Lunatic Center. And when Scorsese did the movie Shutter Island, he was wanting to do the Tower of Horrors in this tower, okay? And a new hospital has been built next to it, and these two ladies were the ones that I worked with, working with adolescents hospitalized in psychiatric with big, big problems. This is the whole faculty team that has invited me now to do that that training to residents, and here is the director of education, and there is the director of the vice chairmans of clinical interventions, and they invite me in that occasion, but nothing happened then. This was in 2011. Now, 4 years later, they told me, please, can we do this than we thought 4 years ago? Yeah. And finally, 4 stages of mindfulness. My cabin, in the woods. The first day, they came and said, we don't believe this, may we take a picture? And I spent there 45 days. One of my teachers of yoga, Swami Swarupananda, he was teaching me pratyahara, control of the senses. We have a Swami for each specialty. Okay, each one was specialized on something. Here with John Kabat-Zinn, and here one of my students that organized the program in Chile recently. Okay, the old and the new generation. And on closing, the only thing I want to say is that I feel privileged that thanks to all the things that I have learned in Theosophy, from all the teachers, my favorite ones, Joy Mills, John Aljo, and Rada Burnier, Virginia Hanson, and many others. And the books, The Divine Plan of Barborka, that I met him when he was our age there in Crotona, gave me the foundations to understand what means to be human, what means to be alive, with all the layers that we study in Theosophy, with everything that HPB, Little Peter, Besan gave to us. I have a library at home, like the library of any Theosophist, 3,000 books. Some of them are 150 years old because we got legacies of people. Oh, my aunt died, and she was having the books of whoever, you know? And I don't think there is not one book there that I had not visited. I have visited all these books. But at the end, you need to make it yours. Need to be your own experience. And then to be able to present it in the language of the people in which you are engaged with. Because is that the only possibility? Repeat, accumulate, like Krishnamurti said, put more stuff into. It's just that accumulation. No, don't memorize. Feel it, move it into, and then because there is a different level of memory. And when you go into stillness, when you are able to listen the voice of the silence, that is what support of the noise. Sound is supported by silence. then it's a fluidity. You don't need to go to the what you wrote. You go to the classroom with a new group of people naked. You know what is the topic, but you and the group, as one, will move through whatever need to be explored. There is not authority in that class, because the wisdom that we are exploring is inside of every single human being. But how we can help those minds to cool down, to quiet, to go into stillness, and allow that wisdom to move freely, and then create a class that is a wonderful thing. There is not an authority there. There is not an authority there. I work with a group of women. I did in prisons in New Jersey, in many different places with different groups. But I did a group of women with HIV/AIDS in English and in Spanish in Worcester for 6 years. And they were the ones inviting people to come to that class to help them. They were dying, practically. And in one occasion, I went to that class, and I have a total of 10 Latino women came with HIV/AIDS. And I was in the teaching mode day. Go to the whiteboard there and start to write and that. And as I turn around, two of the women stand up and start to go to the door. And I turn around and I says, please, what I need to do for you to stay? What I need to do for you to stay? And their answer was, we didn't come to get a lecture. We are tired of lectures. We came because we are suffering. And we have been told that by coming here, this can be tremendously helpful. And I told them, okay, I erase everything that I was writing there. We are going to sit all in this round table, and we are going to explore where that suffering is coming from. And was one of the more beautiful classes that we have. And a lot of things came out from there. But the teacher need to be ready to allow, to withdraw, to let the mask drop, and be just a regular, simple human being. Thank you very much. Very recently, a friend of mine, Dr. Ronald Siegel from Harvard, has put in the great courses, great university courses, the science of mindfulness, a research-based path to wellness. It's a total of 24 classes. He was recently in Madrid. He speaks Spanish very well. He was recently in Madrid teaching, and his daughter is studying medicine with us there in UMass, and she's leading some of the meditation practices there. But it's very good. It's in DVD, and you can see him teaching and all that. And the other one, This one is the Mindful Way Workbook from the three psychologists that I put over there, that has a DVD with 14 tracks that is excellent to do yourself, to do you with your psychologist, your therapist, with groups, etc. It's excellent. And I mentioned that because the book in Spanish was coming with no DVD. And they were pretending the people practice meditation by reading the instructions. And I called immediately, sent an email to my three friends, and they sent me the script in English, and they okay to do the translation. I did it, recorded, and now the book is with the DVD in Spanish. Okay, but this is one of the best ones of all to do the practice, the Mindful Way Workbook. Okay, you can take note after that. And I did for New Jersey, the University of Rutgers University, paid 25% of my salary in UMass to develop a program for the prison system in New Jersey. But I told the researcher from Rutgers that I was not committing to it until I visit the prisons with her. And I did that. I visit 4 different prisons, different levels, and I told her after that, I think I can do it. And then she organized a group in females, maximum security, and I spent 5 days with them in a cell, going through the whole program. They put a rock and they did some decorations, but when we are doing the body scan in the floor, the guards came, moved the big, count time, Jane, whatever. And we were doing our relaxation here, present, you know, that kind of thing. But the good thing is, at the 3rd day of doing the program, they opened the door and said, the guards completely, they changed their attitude, you know? They changed their attitude. And after they asked me, anyway, 1 year later, the researcher asked me to go back again to do a manual with 18 different classes and to train several social workers to continue doing the work in different prisons in the system. And the inmates asked me for a DVD with my presence, leading some of the practices for them to put it in the circuit and within the prison system in New Jersey. Okay, and I call it that 4 stages of mindfulness for stress reduction and recovery, treating anxiety and addictions in involuntary confinement environments.
What does MBSR stand for?
Mindfulness-based stress reduction. And MBCT is mindfulness-based cognitive therapy. But now there are so many MBs systems that we call it mindfulness-based interventions, because there are many. This has grown tremendously.
Would you share a little bit about what you taught the doctors on the floor when you had them relax? Did you do belly breathing and a body scan? What were some of the things you had them do?
Normally, because those are workshops that can be 3-6 hours, I try to do what I think can be more useful to them during the daily routine. But also, I want to give them a flavor of the practices that we do with patients, for them to understand and will be very good to have in that hospital something established for the patients, you know? And you, when you feel it in yourself, then you can do that. Yes, we do a short body scan, we do some abdominal breathing, we do the duration exercise that is working with your senses, putting more attention. Mainly it's just the cultivation of awareness, because the whole program is about the cultivation of awareness. Physical awareness, emotional awareness, mental awareness, spiritual awareness, and the whole thing as a whole. In this case, I just give them taste of things that I think that group will need, or the person that has invited me, I ask the person, what do you think will be more useful here? And they give me the ideas, and then I moved in that direction.
What is your viewpoint, or what is your opinion? You mentioned sound and silence a little earlier. What is your viewpoint or your opinion about using gongs or singing bowls as a supportive tool for the MBSR methods?
We use bells in the class, but one of the things that in MBSR we want to is the people not to depend absolutely on anything. No gizmos, no this, no incense, no little corner, no special nothing, because when you are in the subway or you are in the bus going to work or whatever, you can, I'm going to do, as I am sitting here, a little body scan. So, I don't have my gong. How am I going to do it? I forgot my incense or my little Buddha is in, no. The only thing you need is your body and your breath. Yesterday I was saying, where is your home? Where your feet are? What keeps you living? The breath is it. Now, but don't create dependencies. Sometimes we tell ourselves, we tell stories and poems, but sometimes in some cycles, I will not say one poem in this cycle. to not depend absolutely anything. Always fresh, always beginner's mind, if you had, like you had never done it before. Okay? Because it's the best way for the thing to work. Thanks.
I attended one of his workshops. They are absolutely phenomenal because it takes you to a deeper level. And I'm just putting this humbly because I experienced it. And it was phenomenal for me because 3 days later, I was still processing stuff that had been years. I'm a 70-year-old woman, well, 71 now. And it was just really something to be said for people like myself, who are very smart and very intelligent, and it's a mess. It's hard, and that particular workshop really helped me a lot. That's all I want to say.
Yeah. No, and I tell you, I had not been in that workshop, but I believe you completely. Because I think, I do myself, I had done programs on mantras. I had done programs, I had taken courses on many different things, and are tremendously useful. But in this case with John Kabat-Zinn, what we were wanting is just people. You have a mix of people. You have evangelicals. You have Jehovah's Witnesses. You have Catholics. You have atheists. You have all kind of things. And you need to go very careful on what you bring, because you want to incorporate this in everywhere, in the hospitals and that. But in relation to sound, my chairman in psychiatry, he has allowed people that are teaching that into the programs. And they do it some in the psychiatric units, etc. That is okay. The idea is not to try to mix, because each thing is efficient in its own way. But when you try to mix, you can create some. In one occasion, Saki Santorelli decided, who is the chairman, no, the director now, decided to put music in one of the programs in Omega. And John Kabat-Zinn got a fit. And he said, but this music from this Sufi tradition that Saki comes from, he says, I don't care where it's coming from. But not in my program. And I understand why. Okay? I understand why.
I was wondering if in the hospital, in the prison program, if you had the guards participate in a separate stress reduction effort. Because, I mean, they seem to be, I did hear of there was a project in India a while back. I forget what the name of it was, but they brought some meditation into the prisons. But they had the prisoners and the, not together, but they had the guards and the prisoners go through, because it's both stressful probably to be a prisoner, but it's also very stressful to be a guard.
It's very important.
And you affect each other.
It's very important. I did that. I didn't do it in the prison because I didn't have the chance, but I did it in the psychiatric units of adolescents. We organized to have the staff. In those units, the stress is humongous. These kids, when I ask why these kids are here, they told me, don't ask. They have been abused from birth. They are completely gone. They lose it. It's like an exorcist movie. Kicking their heads, and all created in a way, and you have 40 kids in those conditions. And they have 24 hours staff working there. The tension is constant. They try to find ways to kill themselves or to kill the staff is constant. In this case, I did 4 cycles of 8 weeks with the staff first. And then I was asked to work with the kids. And I tried to work with the kids and was a nightmare. Complete nightmare. Each one was in a complete different page. And I told the director in that unit, says, I cannot do it. He says, well, you cannot say you cannot do it. We pay you. I said, I cannot do it. I had not been trained for this. Why are you going to work with something I don't know? But I stay, continue working with the staff. And then one day, one of the directors of 4 units says, Fernando, one of the kids want to learn how to meditate. Do you think you can do that? And I says, why not? I will need to have an interview with the kid. And they always came with their therapist, their closer therapist. And I have this interview, and I said, this kid was from originally from Vietnam. He came when he was a baby through San Francisco with the family. And when he was going to college, he started to have these compulsions, and he was rotating around himself. He has dull marks here, like spinning, cutting his head, cutting his tongue, losing complete control. And I asked Moy, why you want to learn to meditate? Well, my grandmother, you know, she's Buddhist. And she always meditates every day. Really? He says, yeah. And she's so peaceful. It's for that reason. Do you think you can teach me how to meditate? And I asked him, what do you understand for meditation? And he said, well, something about breathing. Okay, very well. And why we breathe? And then, well, to be alive. Okay, going to put one finger here. What do you notice? And the other side, what do you notice? I start to work with him 3 weeks, the therapist with me, doing the three together, the things. No? 3 weeks later, says, Fernando, may I invite one girl from the unit? And I told her what we are doing, and she thinks that she will be interested on it. And I said, okay. In 4 months, I have 16 kids coming to class. 16. And then I get permission to take them to the woods, to the mountain. And the director told me, what? I says, yeah, may I take the ones who are more manageable, you know? Can we take a group of kids to the mountains? Why? It says, because this is a prison. And adolescents need fresh air. I said, okay. And they're organized, and we got a huge van. I got 2 bodyguards, 2 nurses, and we went to Mount Wachusett to run on the mountain with the struggles, with difficulties, getting mud. I got chocolate and things to give at the end of the whole thing, you know. And then when I did body scan, very short body scan, we did meditation. But because their mind tend to ruminate a lot, they keep everything and goes around and around and around. I says, we are going to do it aloud. And at the end of the body scan, says, okay, repeat after me aloud. May I be safe? And you can hear all the kids. May I be safe? May I be happy? May I be happy? May I be healthy? May I, with so much love, and said, now we're going to send the same energy to the other kids in the units, to the people that help you here, to your families. May you all be safe, and all the kids, may you all be safe. I worked for a year and a half in those units. And now when they ask me finally in psychiatry, Fernando, can you teach the residents mindfulness as part of the curriculum? I says, finally, finally. They decided to do it. And now it's going to be permanent in all the units.
Hi. I just want to say, based on my experience, I've been volunteering as a volunteer directly with groups of prisoners, detainees at the largest on-site detention center in the United States for the last 25 years as, with groups of prisoners and also with volunteers, training volunteers. And the past year and a half, I've also been going into lockdown ward in one of the major hospitals in Chicago. And I want to tell you, I really, really respect, admire, and appreciate what you're doing. And we sure could use you at Cook County Jail, okay? Because the detainees get then sent in other places in Illinois to the prisons, and many times, you know, across the country as well, of course. Mm. And there's always the money issue and problem. And I've just been feeling so burned out and mm-hmm. so discouraged. And you've just totally, like, built a fire under me. I'm inspired. And I'm hopeful. And I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart.
Okay, thanks.